this. Yeah, so my name is Grant Wheeler. I'm an ASMSU senator for on campus. And today's book, I'm reading from The Call of the Wild. This is by Jack London, one of my favorite books I've ever read outside of class. Just a little bit of background on this book, why it was banned. It was banned in Italy in 1929 and Yugoslavia. It was also burned in Nazi bonfires in 1933. So this was more kind of an international ban, but I really like this book because it depicts nature through someone else's eyes, the eyes of a dog. And that dog's name is Buck. He's the main character in this book. He's a 140-pound St. Bernard, so just to let you know that. Also, just to let you know some other things so that you can kind of understand what's going on in the story, Francois and Perrault are two mushers that are in charge of the dog sled team. And Spitz is the team leader. He's the dog that's in charge of all the other dogs. So with that, I'm going to start my story. It starts in Canada, so we're going towards the coast. 7 days from the time they pulled into Dawson, they dropped down the steep bank by the barracks to the Yukon Trail and pulled by Daia in salt water. Perrault was carrying dispatches, if anything more urgent than those he had brought in. Also, the travel pride had gripped him, and he purposed to make the record trip of the year. Several things favored him in this. The week's rest had recuperated the dogs and put them in thorough trim. The trail they had broken into the country was packed hard by later journeyers. And further, the police had arranged in two or three places deposits of grub for the dog and man he was traveling light. He made 60 Mile, which is a 50-mile run, on the first day. And the second day saw them booming up the Yukon well on their way to Pelly. With such splendid, running was achieved not without great trouble and vexation on the part of Francois. The insidious revolt led by Buck had destroyed the solitary team of the team. It no longer was a one dog leaping in traces. The encouragement of Buck gave the rebels led them into all kinds of petty misdemeanors. No more was Spitz a leader greatly to be feared. The old awe departed, and they grew equal to challenging his authority. Pike robbed him of half a fish one night and gulped it down under the protection of Buck. Another night, Dub and Joe fought Spitz and made him forego the punishment they deserved. And even Billy, the good-natured, was less good-natured, and whined not half as placatingly as in former days. Buck never came near Spitz without snarling and bristling menacingly. In fact, his conduct approached that of a bully, and he was given to swaggering up and down before Spitz's very nose. The breaking down of discipline likewise affected the dogs and the relations with one another. They quarreled and bickered more than ever among themselves, till at times the camp was a howling bedlam. Dave and Solix alone were unaltered, though they were made irritable by the unending squabbling. Francois swore strange, barbarous oaths, and stamped the snow in futile rage and tore his hair. His lash was always singing among the dogs, but it was of small avail. Directly his back was turned, they were at it again. He backed up Spitz with his whip, while Buck backed up the remainder of the team. Francois knew he was beheld all the trouble, and Buck knew he knew. But Buck was too clever ever again to be caught red-handed. He worked faithfully in the harness, for the toil had become a delight to him. Yet it was a greater delight slyly to precipitate fight among his mates and tangle the traces. At the mouth of the Tequina, one night after supper, Dub turned up a snowshoe rabbit, blundered it, and missed. In a second, the whole team was in full cry. 100 yards away was a camp of the Northwest Police with 50 dogs, huskies all, who joined the chase. The rabbit sped down the river, turned off into a small creek, up the frozen bed of which it held steadily. It ran lightly on the surface of the snow while the dogs plowed through by main strength. Buck led the pack, 60 strong, around bend after bend, but he could not gain. He lay down low to the race, whining eagerly, his splendid body flashing forward leap by leap in the wan white moonlight. And leap by leap, like some pale frost wraith, the snowshoe rabbit flashed on ahead. All that stirring of old instincts, which at stated periods drives men out from the sounding cities to forest and plain to kill things by chemically propelled leaden bullets, pellets, the bloodlust, the joy to kill, all this was Buck's, only it was infinitely more intimate. He was ranging at the head of the pack, running the wild thing down, the living meat to kill with his own teeth and wash his muzzle to the eyes in warm blood. There is an ecstasy that marks the summit of life, and beyond which life cannot rise. And such is the paradox of living. This ecstasy comes when one is most alive, and it comes as a complete forgetfulness that one is alive. This ecstasy, this forgetfulness of the living, comes to the artist, caught up out of himself in a sheet of flame. It comes to the soldier, war mad on a stricken field and refusing quarter. And it came to Buck, leading the pack, sounding the old wolf cry, straining after the food that was alive and that fled swiftly before him through the moonlight. He was sounding the deeps of his nature and the parts of his nature that were deeper than he, going back into the womb of time. He was mastered by the sheer surging of life, the tidal wave of being, the perfect joy of each separate muscle, joint, and sinew, and that it was everything that was not death, that it was aglow and rampant, expressing itself in movement, flying exultingly under the stars and over the face of dead matter that did not move. But Spitz, cold and calculating, even in his supreme moods, left the pack and cut a narrow neck of land where the creek made a long bend around. Buck did not know this, and as he rounded the bend, the frost wraith of a rabbit still flitting before him, he saw another and larger frost wraith leap from the overhanging bank into the immediate path of rabbit. It was Spitz. The rabbit could not turn, and as the white teeth broke its back in midair, it shrieked as loudly as a stricken man may shriek. At sound of this, the cry of life plunging down from life's apex in the grip of death, the full pack at Buck's heels raised a hellish chorus of delight. Buck did not cry out. He did not check himself, but drove in upon Spitz, shoulder to shoulder, so hard that he missed the throat. They rolled over and over in the powdery snow. Spitz gained his feet almost as though he had not been overthrown, slashing Buck down the shoulder and leaping clear. Twice his teeth clipped together, like the steel jaws of a trap, as he backed away for better footing, with lean and lifting lips that writhed and snarled. In a flash, Buck knew it. The time had come. It was to the death. As they circled about, snarling, ears laid back, keenly watchful for the advantage, the scene came to Buck with a sense of familiarity. He seemed to remember it all, the white woods and earth and moonlight and the thrill of battle. Over the whiteness and silence brooded a ghostly calm. There was not the faintest whisper of ear. Nothing moved, not a leaf quivered, the visible breaths of the dogs rising slowly and lingering in the frosty air. They had made short work of the snowshoe rabbit, these dogs that were ill-tamed wolves, and they were now drawn in up in an expectant circle. They too were silent, their eyes only gleaming and their breaths drifting slowly upward. To Buck, it was nothing new or strange, the scene of old time. It was as though it had always been, the wonted way of things. Spitz was a practiced fighter, from Spitsbergen through the Arctic and across Canada and the Barrens. He had held his own with all manner of dogs and achieved a mastery over them. Bitter rage was his, but never blind rage. In passion to rend and destroy, he never forgot that his enemy was in like passion to rend and destroy. He never rushed till he was prepared to receive a rush. He never rushed till he was prepared to receive a rush, never attacked till he first defended that attack. In vain, Buck strove to sink his teeth in the neck of the big white dog. Wherever his fangs struck for the softer flesh, they were countered by the fangs of Spitz. Fang clashed fang, and lips were cut and bleeding, but Buck could not penetrate his enemy's guard. Then he warmed up and enveloped Spitz in a whirlwind of rushes. Time and time again he tried for the snow-white throat, the life bubbled near to the surface, and each time and every time Spitz slashed him and got away. Then Buck took to rushing, as though for the throat, when suddenly drawing back his head and curving in from the side, he would drive his shoulder at the shoulder of Spitz, as a ram by which to overthrow him. But instead, Buck's shoulder was slashed down each time as Spitz leaped away lightly. Spitz was untouched, while Buck was streaming with blood and panting hard. The fight was growing desperate, and all the while, the silent and wolfish circle waited to finish off whichever dog went down. As Buck grew winded, Spitz took to the rushing, and he kept him staggering for footing. Once, Buck went over, and the whole circle of 60 dogs started up, but he recovered himself almost in mid-air, and the circle sank down again and waited. Buck possessed a quality that made for greatness, imagination. He fought by instinct, but he could fight by head as well. He rushed as though attempting the old shoulder trick, but at the last instant swept low to the snow and in, his teeth closed on Spitz's left foreleg. There was a crunch of breaking bone, and the white dog faced him on three legs. Thrice he tried to knock him over, then repeated the trick and broke the right foreleg. Despite the pain and helplessness, Spitz struggled madly to keep up. He saw the silent circle with gleaming eyes, lolling tongues, and silvery breaths drifting upward, closing in upon him as he had seen similar circles closing upon beaten antagonists in the past. Only this time, he was the one who was beaten. There was no hope for him. Buck was inexorable. Mercy was a thing reserved for gentler climes. He maneuvered for the final rush. The circle had tightened until he could feel the breaths of the huskies on his flanks. He could see them beyond Spitz and to either side, half crouching for the spring, their eyes fixed upon him. A pause seemed to fall. Every animal was motionless as though turned to stone. Only Spitz quivered and bristled as he staggered back and forth, snarling with horrible menace as though to frighten off impending death. Then Buck sprang in and out. While he was in, shoulder had at last had it last squarely met shoulder. The dark circle became a dot on the moon-flooded snow as Spitz disappeared from view. Buck stood and looked on, the successful champion, the dominant beast who had made his kill and found it good. So guys, that's it for me. Just to let you know, this little thing about this, I actually got this from this library, so if you guys actually want to read this book, just a little plug there.
My name is Jessica Payne. I'm a senator for ASMSU as well. And today I'm reading To Kill a Mockingbird by Harper Lee. And I chose this book because to me it's a beautifully well-written, humorous, and provocative story, and undoubtedly a classic of American literature. And while this novel is narrated through the eyes of a child, it deals with serious adult themes and issues that are still prevalent and significant to us today. These issues include race, class, gender, incest, friendship, courage, death, and innocence. And those are just to name a few. Since its publication in 1960, To Kill a Mockingbird has been banned and challenged in various parts for various reasons. In Eden Valley, Minnesota in 1977, it was temporarily banned due to the words such as damn and whore lady used in the novel. It was banned in Lindale, Texas in 1966. On the advanced placement English reading list because the book contained words and issues that conflicted with the values of the community. The part that I'm going to read to you is right after the jury had found Tom Robinson, a black man who was accused of rape. They found him guilty of raping a white woman named Mayella, and Atticus, a widowed father, is talking to his daughter, Scout, and Jem about the trial and issues such as race, class, rape, and incest. After that, we are not afraid. Summer was melting away, and we made the most of it. Atticus assured us that nothing would happen to Tom Robinson until the higher court reviewed his case, and that Tom had a good chance of going free, or at least having a new trial. He was at Enfield Prison Farm, 70 miles away in Chester County. I asked Atticus if Tom's wife and children were allowed to visit him. Atticus said no. If he loses his appeal, I asked one evening, what'll happen to him? He'll go to the chair, said Atticus, unless the government commutes his sentence. Not to worry yet, Scout. We've got a good chance. Jem was sprawled on the sofa reading Popular Mechanics. He looked up. It ain't right. He didn't kill anybody, but he was guilty. He didn't take anybody's life. You know rape's a capital offense in Alabama, said Atticus. Yes, sir, but the jury didn't have to give him death. If they wanted, they could have given 20 years. Give it, said Atticus. Tom Robinson's a colored man, Jim. No jury in this part of the world's going to say, we think you're guilty, but not very, on a charge like that. It was either straight acquittal or nothing. Jim was shaking his head. I know it's not right, but I can't figure out what's wrong. Maybe rape shouldn't be a capital offense. Atticus dropped his newspaper beside his chair. He said he didn't have any quarrel with the rape statute, none whatsoever. But he did have deep misgivings when the state asked for and the jury gave a death penalty on the purely circumstantial evidence. He glanced at me, so I was listening and made it easier. I mean, before a man is sentenced to death for murder, say there should be at least one or two eyewitnesses. Someone should be able to say, yes, I was there and I saw him pull the trigger. Well, lots of folks have been hanged on circumstantial evidence, said Jim. I know, and lots of them probably deserved it too, but in the absence of eyewitnesses, there's always a doubt, sometimes only a shadow of doubt. The law says reasonable doubt, but I think a defendant's entitled to a shadow of doubt. There's always the possibility, no matter how improbable, that he's innocent. Then it all goes back to the jury then. We ought to do away with juries, Jim was adamant. Atticus tried hard not to smile, but couldn't help it. You're rather hard on us, son. I think maybe there might be a better way. Change the law. Change it so that only judges have the power of fixing penalty in capital cases. Then go up to Montgomery and change the law. You'd be surprised how hard that'd be. I won't live to see the law changed, and if you live to see it, you'll be an old man. This is not good enough for Jim. No, sir, they ought to do away with juries. He wasn't guilty in the first place, and they said he was. If you've been on the jury, son, and 11 other boys like you, Tom would be a free man, said Atticus. So far, nothing in your life has interfered with your reasoning process. Those are 12 reasonable men in everyday life, Tom's jury, but you saw something become between them and reason. You saw the same thing that night in front of the jail. When that crew went away, they didn't go away as reasonable men. They went because we were there. There's something in our world that makes men lose their heads. It couldn't be fair if they tried. In our courts, when it's a white man's world against a black man's, the white always wins. They're ugly, but those are the facts of life. Doesn't make it right, said Jim. He beat his first fist softly on his knee. You just can't convict a man on evidence like that. You can't. You couldn't, but they couldn't did. The older you grow, the more you'll see it. One place where a man ought to get a square deal is in the courtroom, be any color of the rainbow. But people have a way of carrying their resentments right to the jury box. As you grow older, you'll see white men beat black men every day of your life. But let me tell you something, and don't you forget it. Whenever a white man does that to a black man, no matter where he is, how rich he is, or how fine a family he comes from, the white man is trash. Atticus was speaking so quietly, his last words crashed in our ears. I looked up and his face was venomous. There's nothing more sickening to me than a low-grade white man who'll take advantage of a Negro's innocence. Don't fool yourself. It's all adding up, and one of these days you're going to pay the bill for it. I hope it's not in your children's time. Jim was scratching his head. Suddenly his eyes widened. Atticus, he said. Why don't people like us and Miss Maudie ever sit on juries? You never see anybody from Maycomb on a jury. They all come out in the woods. Atticus leaned back in the rocking chair. For some reason, he looked pleased with Jim. I was wondering when that occurred to you. There are lots of reasons. For one thing, Miss Maudie can't serve on a jury because she's a woman. You mean women in Alabama can't? I was indignant. I do. I guess it's to protect our frail ladies from sordid cases like Tom's. Besides, Atticus grinned, I doubt if we ever get a complete case tried. The ladies being interrupting to ask questions. Jim and I laughed. Miss Maudie on a jury would be impressive. I thought of old Miss Du Bois in her wheelchair. Stop that rapping, John Taylor. I want to ask this man something. Perhaps our forefathers were wise. Atticus was saying, with people like this, like us, that's our share of the bill. We generally get the juries we deserve. Our stout Maycomb citizens aren't interested in the first place. In the second place, they're afraid. Then they're afraid why? Asked Jim. Well, what if, say, Mr. Link Diaz had to decide the amount of damages to award, say, Miss Maudie, when Miss Rachel ran her over with the car. Link wouldn't like the thought of losing either lady's business at his store, wouldn't he? So he tells Judge Taylor that he can't serve on the jury because he doesn't have anybody to keep store for him while he's gone. So Judge Taylor excuses him. Something he excuses him wrathfully. Wrathfully. What made him think either of them stopped trading with him? I asked. Jim said, Miss Rachel wouldn't, Miss Maudie wouldn't, but a jury's voice votes secret, Atticus. Our father chuckled. We've many miles to go, son. A jury's vote's supposed to be secret. Serving on a jury forces a man to make up his mind and declare himself about something. Men don't like to do that. Sometimes it's unpleasant. Tom's jury, though, sure made up its mind in a hurry, Jim muttered. Atticus' fingers went to his watch pocket. No, it didn't, he said, more to himself than us. That was the one thing that made me think, well, this may be the shadow of a beginning. The jury took a few hours, an inevitable verdict, maybe, but usually it takes them just a few minutes. This time, he broke off and looked at us. You might like to know that there was one fellow who took considerable wearing down. In the beginning, he was wearing for an outright acquittal. Who? Jim asked, astonished. Atticus' eyes twinkles. It's not for me to say, but I'll tell you this much. He was one of your old serum friends. One of the Cunninghams? Jim yelped. I didn't recognize any of them. You're joking. He looked at Atticus out of the corners of his eyes. One of their connections on a hunch? I didn't strike him, just on a hunch. Couldn't, but I didn't. Golly Moses, Jim said reverently. One minute they're trying to kill him, and the next they're trying to turn him loose. I'll never understand those folks as long as I live. Atticus said you just had to know him. He said that Cunninghams hadn't taken anything from or off of anybody since they migrated to the New World. He said the other thing about them was, once you earned their respect, they were yours tooth and nail. Atticus said he had a feeling, nothing more than a suspicion, that they left the jail that night with considerable respect for the Finches. Then too, he said, it took a thunderbolt plus another Cunningham to make one of them change his mind. If we had two of that crowd, we'd have had a hung jury. Jim said slowly, you mean you actually put on the jury a man who wanted to kill you the night before? How could you take such a risk, Atticus? How could you? When you analyze it, there's a little risk. There's no difference between one man who's going to convict and another man who's going to convict, is there? There's a faint difference between a man who's going to convict and a man who's a little disturbed in his mind, isn't there? He was the only uncertainty on the whole list. What kin was that man to Mr. Walter Cunningham, I asked. Atticus rose, stretching yawn. It was not even our bedtime. But we knew he wanted a chance to read his newspaper. Picked it up, folded it, and tapped my head. Let's see now, he droned himself. I got it. Double first cousin. How can that be? Two sisters marry two brothers. That's all I'll tell you. You figure it out. I tortured myself and decided that if I married Jim and Dill and had a sister whom he married our children, we'd be double first cousins. Gee, Minity, Jim, I said. when Addis is gone. They're funny folks. Did you hear that? This book is also in the library if you guys want to check it out. It's really a great story.
My name is Teresa Snyder, and I am the student body president here at Montana State University, and I will be reading a book called The Butter Battle Book, which is a hidden gem by the children's writer Dr. Seuss. Published in 1984, this New York Times Notable Book of the Year reflects the concerns of the Cold War era, including the possibility that all life on Earth could be destroyed with a nuclear war. The Butter Battle Book was removed from library shelves in the mid-1980s due to its position regarding the arms race. I chose this reading because of its creative approach in teaching children about current events. I give to you the Butter Battle Book. On the last day of summer, 10 hours before fall, my grandfather took me out to the wall. For a while he stood silent, then finally he said, with a very sad shake of his very old head, "As you know, on this side of the wall, we are Utes. On the far other side of the wall live the Zooks." My grandfather said, "It's high time that you knew of the terrible, horrible things that Zooks do. In every Zook house and in every Zook town, every Zook eats his bread with the butter side down. But we Utes, as you know, when we breakfast or sup, spread our bread," Grandpa said, "with the butter side up. That's the right, honest way," Grandpa gritted his teeth. "So you can't trust a Zook who spreads bread underneath. Every Zook must be watched. He has kinks in his soul. That's why, as a youth, I made watching my goal, watching Zooks for the Zook-watching Border Patrol." In those days, of course, the wall wasn't so high, and I could look any Zook square in the eye. If he dared to come close, I could give him a twitch with my prickly snickberry switch. For a while that worked fine, all the Zooks stayed away, and our country was safe. Then one terrible day, a very rude Zook by the name of Van Itch snuck up and slingshotted my snitchberry switch. With my broken off switch and my head held in shame, to the chief Yukaroo in great sorrow I came. But our leader just smiled. He said, "You're not to blame, and those Zooks will be sorry they started this game. We'll dress you right up in a fancier suit, and we'll give you a fancier slingshot to shoot." And he ordered the boys in the back room to figure how to build me some sort of triple sling jigger. With my triple sling jigger, I sure felt much bigger. I marched the wall with great vim and great vigor, right up to Van Itch with my hand on the trigger. "I'll have no more nonsense," I said with a frown, "from Zooks who eat bread with the butter side down." Van Itch looked quite sickly, and he ran off quite quickly. I'm unhappy to say that he came back the next day with a spiffy new suit and a big new machine, and he snarled and said, looking frightfully mean, You may fling those hard rocks with your triple sling jigger, but I also now have my hand on the trigger. My wonderful weapon, the jigger rock snatch'em, we'll fling 'em right back just as quick as we catch 'em. We'll have no more nonsense, we'll take no more gup from you Utes who eat bread with the butter side up. "I have failed, sir," I sobbed as I made my report to the chief Yukaroo in the headquarters fort. He just laughed, "You've done nothing of the sort. Our slingshots have failed, that was old-fashioned stuff. Slingshots, dear boy, are not modern enough. All we need is some newfangled kind of a gun. My boys in the back room have already begun to think up a walloping whizzinger one. My bright boys are thinking, they're right on track. They'll think up one quick and we'll send you right back." They thought up a quick one, they certainly did. They thought up a gun called the Kickapoo Kid, which they loaded with powerful poo-a-doo powder and ant eggs and bees legs and dried fried clam chowder. And they carefully trained a real smart dog named Daniel to serve as our country's first dog first gun-toting spaniel. Then Daniel, the kickaboo spaniel, and I marched back to the wall with our heads held up high, while everyone cheered and their cheers filled the sky. Fight, fight for the butter side up, do or die. Well, we didn't do, and we didn't quite die, but we sure did get worsened, poor Daniel and I. Vantage was there too when he said that old pig, my boys in the back room invented this rig. It's called the 8-nozzle elephant toted bomb blitz. It shoots high explosive sour cherry stone pits. And will you put your dumb kickapoo kid on the fritz? Poor Daniel and I were scared out of our wits. Once more, by Vantage, I was bested and beat. Once again, I limped home from the wall in defeat. I dragged and I sagged. My spirits were low as I thought they ever could go. When I heard a boom-bah and a diddle-dee-dill, and our butter-up band marched up over the hill. The chief yookaroo had sent them to meet me, along with the right-side-up song girls to greet me. Oh, be faithful, believe in thy butter, they sang, and they lifted my spirits high out of the gutter. My boys, smiled Chief Yookaroo, we've just voted and made you a general. You've been promoted. Your pretty new uniform's ready. Get in it. The big war is coming, and you're going to begin it. And what's more, this time, you're certain to win it. My boys in the back room have finally found how. Just wait till you see what they've puttered up now. In the great new machine, you'll fly over that wall and clobber those buttered down Zeus, one and all. Those boys in the back room sure knew how to putter. They made me a thing called an utterly sputter, and I jumped aboard with my heart all aflutter and steered toward the land of upside-down butter. This machine was so modern, so frightfully new, no one knew quite exactly what it would do. But it had several faucets that sprinkled blue goo, which somehow would sprinkle the zooks as I flew and gum up the upside-down butter they chew. I was racing pell-mell when I heard a voice yell, if you sprinkle less zooks, we'll get you sprinkled as well. Then Itch had a sputter exactly like mine, and he yelled, my blue gooer is working just fine, and I'm here to say that if zooks can goo zooks, you'd better forget it, because zooks can goo yooks. I flew right back home, and as you may have guessed, I was downright despondent, disturbed, and depressed. I was, and I saw just as soon as I stepped back on land, so were all the girls in the butter-up band. The chief majorette, Ms. Yuki Ansu, said, that was a pretty sour flight that you flew, and the chief Yukaroo has been looking for you. I raced to his office. The place was a sight. Have no fear, said the chief. Everything is all right. My bright backroom boys have been brighter than bright. They've thought up a gadget that's newer than new. It's filled with a mysterious mulaka moo. And can blow all those zoops clear to Salamagoo. They've invented the bitsy big boy boomeroo. You just run to that wall like a nice little man and drop this bomb on the zooks just as fast as you can. I have ordered all yooks to stay safe underground while the bitsy big boy boomeroo is around. As I raced for the wall with the bomb in my hand, I noticed that every last yook in our land was obeying our chief yookaroo's grim command. They were all bravely marching with banners of flutter down a hole for their country and right set up butter. That's when Grandfather found me. He grabbed me and said, you should be down in that hole and you're up here instead. But perhaps this is better somehow, and you will see me make history right here and right now. Grandpa leapt on that wall with a lupulous leap, and he cleared his throat with a bopulous beep. He screamed, here's the end of that terrible town full of zooks who eat bread with the butter side down. And at that very instant, we heard a clup-clup, a feet on the wall, and old Vantage clupped up. The boys in his back room had made him one too, and his fist was another big boy boomeroo. I'll blow you up, he yelled, into pork and wee beans. I'll butter side up you to small smithereens. Grandpa, I shouted, be careful, oh gee, who's gonna drop it? Will you or will he? Be patient, said Grandpa. We'll see. We will see.